any ballpark numbers, that's not a bad one to keep in mind. So we've got all of this. For the first case, what we're looking at, mean free path of around 0.1 centimeters. And the second case, we're looking at a mean free path of around 100 centimeters. Now that we've got this, we've got some numerical parameters over here. It's just plug and chug with a calculator. What sort of values did you all get for these two limits? What did you get for pressure for the 0.1 centimeter case? Yeah.
This is just like a question that's related. So for the second part, if you're like mean free path is like 100 centimeters and you're like pose is like 1 centimeter, does that mean you have to like treat constituents individually and solve it like a different way? Or like, can you use still the same gas equation or do you have to do something else? I guess that was very like.
You should.
how would your problem solving like change if you can't? Because these are gas.
So, good question. Certainly in terms of ideal gas behavior, we are in the very dynamic case. That's absolutely fine. This is fine too. I guess what I think the only place you need to worry about this is that if you're actually doing calculations that sort of assume the fluid behavior of the gas, okay? So here, I don't think anything changes here. We could just go ahead and use this. Our ideal gas criterion is still fine. But in terms of its behavior as it passes through the hose, then in one case, treating it as a fluid is fine, the other case is definitely not.
Okay, so as far as gas equations don't assume any like fluid like behavior.
Yeah, we're not assuming anything in here that has to do with the nature of it being sort of fluid as such, and things that we might discuss when we talked about fluids last semester. So this just depends on the ideal gas equation being valid, and it clearly isn't. So what sort of numbers do you get in terms of pressures? Do you want to go the full way to get? Yeah.
103.678
pascals for the first one. Say that again? 103.678. Okay. So around 100 pascals. Okay. Thank you, Elizabeth. And for the long B free path case? No big surprise. Yes, exactly. Right. So it's around, what is this, around 10 to the minus 2 pascals. Okay. That result may be not so useful, but what I think is good just to get a sense of is pressure versus mean free path dependencies. Okay. So a simple way of exploring that. Okay, good. Questions before we come back to specific needs for the last 10 minutes? Yeah?
Why is the cross-sectional area pi d squared rather than like pi r squared?
Geometrical calculations. But it's definitely because of the both of the objects have the cross-sectional size. I actually can't quite remember how many units per acre to get the actual cross-sectional collision area. But that's where it comes from.
Oh, so that information doesn't.
Okay, so just in the last few moments, I just want to get at least one last important result up, and then we are good to go. Okay, so let's come back and look at our heat capacities and see what we can learn from this. So what have we learned earlier today? We know that we can describe the kinetic energy in terms of temperature. So I'm just going to look at a small temperature change. So for small temperature change, dT, that means I can write the corresponding change in kinetic energy. Just this, fine. Then I'm going to take us back to last week and remind you the relationship we had in terms of thermal energy transfer. We had this. Okay, so this was in terms of heat capacities. Got a temperature amount, a amount of thermal energy transfer, that should really be delta T. I'm about to make this differential as well. And here's our coefficient corresponding to the heat capacity. So what I'm going to do is make this explicitly for a small change. So Q equals NC dT. Okay, so that's one thing. Now what I'm going to do is a little bit of a special case which will become more important for us on Thursday. When we look at thermodynamical processes involving gases and total energy transfer, we're going to see on Thursday that we may have to worry about cases where the gas changes volume. Why? Because if a gas changes volume, as we will learn, it's presumably in most cases doing work in order to do so. And so because when we've got gases changing volume, work is done, that means some energy goes into doing that work, we're going to have to distinguish going forward between processes that take place at constant volume versus constant temperature. Constant pressure. Maybe constant temperature as well, but for now, constant pressure. And so what that means is we better be careful about our coefficient here, the heat capacity. And so we're going to introduce cases where it's either constant volume or constant pressure. So expected notation, depending on whether we're in one or two of these two criteria. Okay, so in order to avoid for now that complication of work being done and volume changes, I'm going to specifically look at constant volume. So special case now of a constant volume process when we're talking about heat capacities. So I'm going to use CV, which means I'm taking a special case of constant volume. Okay. Again, we'll loosen this restriction on Thursday, but for now it's in place. All right. So if we are with our simple ideal gas here, we're going to elaborate on this also on Thursday. If we're assuming that all of the thermal energy is in the form of translational kinetic energy, we can presumably relate dQ and dK in these two equations. Okay? Let me say that again, it's important. If we're assuming that all of the energy is in translational kinetic energy in this gas, we can presumably talk about the kinetic energy and the thermal energy being the same thing. So, let me, out of time and a little bit out of space, but let me try and wrap this up. Assuming all the energy is in translational kinetic energy, and the reason I'm emphasizing this is because we're about to relax that constraint on Thursday, then I can say that dq equals dk, these two equations, and then I can relate these two. So I get 3 halves mr, okay, I've got dt here, and over here I've got mcv dt. With a little bit of simplification should give me the desired result, which is that the heat capacity in this special case of the constant volume process is a very simple form. Three halves R, okay? So, let me just quickly wrap up here. It was not quite the most elegant close, but what we're doing now is going back, looking at heat capacity, we're looking at what we know about this at the microscopic level, assuming all the energy is in purely translational kinetic energy. We can relate these two, and we get this very simple expression for the heat capacity of constant volume, which is just 3/2 the ideal gas phase, okay? Important result. Let me just, in closing, say why this is interesting as we go forward. We can start to look at the constituents of our gas and make them more interesting than just simply monatomic gases. We can add complexity by looking at more complicated molecular structures. And just to ask you a question before we wrap up, if we have more complex molecular structures, can you imagine ways in which energy might be stored in gas other than in purely translational kinetic energy? Vibrational or rotational energy. That's setting the scene for Thursday. Okay? All right, let's stop there. I'll see you guys either in office hour or in class on Thursday. And if somebody can press the red button on there, thank you.